Hello, I'm Susan Apkon, the Fischus Chair of Pediatric Rehabilitation at Children's Hospital Colorado and a professor of physical medicine and rehabilitation at University of Colorado School of Medicine. As a co-director of the neuromuscular program at Children's Colorado, I'd like to talk today about the management of boys and young men with Duchenne muscular dystrophy in the primary care setting. As a quick review, Duchenne muscular dystrophy is an X-linked recessive neuromuscular disorder caused by a mutation in the dystrophin gene. Dystrophin is a cytoskeletal protein that is instrumental in the strength and function of the muscle fibers. When there's an absence of the dystrophin protein, the muscle fiber integrity is compromised, leading to muscle breakdown and the subsequent and progressive weakness that we observe in boys with this condition. The associated medical conditions, including cardiomyopathy and restrictive lung disease, are related to the disease itself, with endocrine issues including growth delay, weight gain, low bone density, and delayed puberty associated with the glucocorticoid treatment. It's an incredible time in neuromuscular medicine, as there are now FDA-approved treatments for boys with Duchenne muscular dystrophy, and many clinical trials using novel medications are underway. However, there is still not a cure, and therefore optimizing medical management through close monitoring and early intervention is key. While most boys will receive care in the comprehensive neuromuscular clinic, such as the one we have at Children's Colorado, all boys will receive care in the primary care setting. I'm a big advocate for the primary care medical home, and therefore, it's critical for primary care providers to be familiar with Duchenne muscular dystrophy. In 2018, Lancet Neurology published a series of 3 articles presenting evidence-based guidelines to assure that all boys and men with Duchenne are receiving the highest standard of care. Part 3 of this series focused on primary care and emergency management. In addition, a more focused article was published in Pediatrics in the fall of 2018 to further define the primary care provider's role in the day-to-day management of their patients with Duchenne. In the next few minutes, I'm going to review some general health guidelines as well as a discussion of a couple of acute problems that you may encounter in the primary care setting. The care guidelines recommend that the administration of routine childhood immunizations should occur in the primary care setting and according to the CDC immunization schedule. Given that the use of corticosteroids is standard of care, consideration needs to be given to those taking greater than 20 milligrams or 2 milligrams per kilogram per day of prednisone or an equivalent, as those boys are considered immunosuppressed. Live vaccines, such as the MMR and varicella, should be avoided. The primary care provider and neuromuscular team should work together to assure that these immunizations are given prior to the initiation of steroids. The pneumococcal vaccine is recommended, as well as an annual influenza vaccine using the inactive form, given the respiratory complications that boys experience. All family members should also be immunized against influenza. The primary care setting is an excellent venue to discuss growth and nutrition and should start with assuring that heights and weights can be appropriately measured, which can be especially challenging when a boy becomes non-ambulatory. I encourage clinics who care for children with special healthcare needs to have a wheelchair scale. Measurement of height in the non-ambulatory child can be achieved through a supine measurement, use of arm span, or ulnar length as a surrogate. Not surprising, weight management in the setting of corticosteroids can be very challenging and a perfect opportunity for the PCP to provide general nutritional advice. In the setting of a boy who is not gaining weight, I recommend a further discussion to determine whether there are any symptoms or signs of dysphagia that suggest a further evaluation is needed. Routine dental care is also recommended and should not be different from other children. A frequent question does come up if dental restoration is required, as families are educated about the risk to their son when given inhaled anesthetics. The use of local anesthetics and inhaled nitric oxide is safe and should be used without concern. The guidelines also focus the role of the PCP in addressing safety concerns, school-related issues, including the need for an IEP or 504 plan, assessing for mood and adjustment, identifying community resources to help support the child and his family, and initiating the discussion about transition of care when a boy reaches adolescence. I want to now transition this conversation towards the presentation of some common problems we see in boys with Duchenne. The care guidelines emphasize the primary care's role in the initial evaluation and management of these problems, with a recognition that in the case of more severe symptoms, the family may seek immediate care in an emergency department setting. When evaluating a boy for new symptoms, it's important to remember the associated medical conditions, such as cardiomyopathy and restrictive lung disease, because the differential diagnosis and treatment may be very different than a child without Duchenne. The age and stage of the child is another important consideration. The recommendations in the care guidelines are broken into the ambulatory stage, the early non-ambulatory stage, and the late non-ambulatory stage to highlight some of these differences. In a child presenting to your office with acute back pain, you should think about vertebral compression fractures, which are relatively common in the setting of a boy on corticosteroids. A lateral spine film is recommended to assess for these fractures. The treatment acutely is symptom relief with a medication such as acetaminophen. The distal femur is the most common location for an extremity fracture and should be suspected when a boy presents with pain or swelling after a fall. Because of the low bone density, a limb fracture can occur even when there's minimal to no trauma. The 2018 care guidelines provide a robust discussion of the monitoring and treatment of low bone density and the need for close follow-up with an endocrinologist to guide this workup. When evaluating shortness of breath or other respiratory symptoms, you should be aware of the child's baseline cardiac and pulmonary status, as the symptoms could reflect worsening heart failure instead of a pulmonary issue. Complaints of dyspnea is more likely to represent a pulmonary cause, such as a viral or bacterial pneumonia, atelectasis, or a worsening of their chronic hypoventilation. A very rare but real cause can be fat emboli syndrome in the setting of a long bone fracture. In the setting of hypoxemia, use of oxygen supplementation alone should be used cautiously, as hypoventilation may be the cause of the low saturation. In the later stages of this disease, you may not see the increased work of breathing because of the muscle weakness. A boy with respiratory symptoms who is in the late non-ambulatory stage should be seen in an emergency department setting because of the risk of acute decompensation. Early and empiric use of antibiotics is recommended. Use of equipment, including non-invasive ventilation, such as BiPAP, and a cough assist device is a critical part of their treatment. The 2018 care guidelines recommend an evaluation by a pulmonologist at the time of diagnosis and while still ambulatory at least yearly, and then twice yearly once the boy becomes non-ambulatory. The cardiac recommendations include a baseline cardiac evaluation at the time of the initial diagnosis of Duchenne and yearly thereafter. I refer you to the care guidelines for more specific details about the respiratory and cardiac management of boys and men with Duchenne. The final point I'd like to review is focused once again on the use of corticosteroids. Because of the long-term use of this medication, boys are expected to be adrenally suppressed. In the setting of an acute illness, a fracture, or the need for a surgical intervention, it is important to provide stress doses of steroids. The care guidelines provide recommendations for stress doses, as well as an online reference called the P.J. Nikoloff Steroid Protocol, which can be accessed by anyone in any setting. Life expectancy has improved over the course of the last 20 years and is due to proactive monitoring and treatment by a comprehensive team of medical providers, including the primary care provider. The 2018 care guidelines and the associated articles in Pediatrics provides PCPs with a comprehensive roadmap to assure that this care is provided at the highest level. If you would like further information about the care guidelines or the care of boys with Duchenne muscular dystrophy, please call 720-777-2806. Thank you.